All right, good morning. It's June 20th, 2022, and I'm here for the free coaching call that we do every single Monday morning, 10 a.m. Pacific time, 7 a.m. in Hawaii, where Anna is. I always shout out Anna, that's always here bright and early Hawaii time. So coaching today, you know, I prepped for the call this morning as I do every week, and I was really thinking of what's the most impactful things that I could talk to you about today. And I've got some things that I think are valuable for you. So number one, the market has shifted, not shifting, not going to shift. It shifted. It shifted very quickly. Matter of fact, we could put our finger on it. March 16th, the first time they raised the rates only that little tiny quarter of a percent, threw the whole market into a tailspin of what was coming, because the interest rates are tied to inflation. They're trying to get in front of inflation that they've created. So now they're going to have to raise rates until they stop inflation. And the, you know, the inflation numbers have been very bad, honestly. They've been really bad, 40-year highs. They thought they started bringing them down with the first couple rates. That didn't work. So now we're above 6% in a standard interest rate loan for FHA. And they raised it three quarters of a percent, 75 basis points last week. What was interesting is rates came down when they raised them three quarters. I know that doesn't make any sense, but they're tied to different things. They're not tied to just the Fed's rate. So when the Fed's raised the rates 75 basis points last week, the rates actually were all the way up to about 6.5. They came back down to about 6. Don't ask me. I don't even understand it. I try to understand it, to coach it, but it's tied to the bond market. There's a lot of things it's tied to. But basically, if you think of it this way, the lenders, and Rich is a lender as well, the lenders get in front of the interest rate increases that are coming to prepare. And then depending on what they do, they kind of adjust and they see where the market's going to land at. I do have an app for you guys that I think is very valuable, I've found, and it's called Mortgage News Daily. Don't know if you could see this, but the app on the App Store looks like a globe. It looks like a globe and it says Mortgage News Daily. Perfect. I see them popping up on the screen. That's a free app and it's really quite nice to look at. So last week it was at 6.55 prior to the rate increase. Rate increase now fell to 6.03. So you could go and look at the trends of that in the last month and you see that it popped up above 6.25 prior to them raising the rates. And then it looks like it came back down to resting right about 6% now. So that's what you could be talking to your clients about, is the fact that the rates are at 6%. I'm not going to get on the soapbox and argue how cool of a rate that is and all that. There's truth to it, that that's a really custom rate that we've seen several times in the last 10 to 12, 15 years. You know, rates started falling in the last recession started in 2006, housing recession. 2006, we started seeing rates start decreasing and we've gone all the way to 2.25 fixed, is which my house is at. Unbelievable, right? And I just did that in like January. So I sound like a superstar, but it was just dumb luck. But I got a fixed rate 2.25. That's an amazing rate. I'm not going to touch that for years and years to come, right? I might have to do HELOCs and do some things, but I'm not going to refinance that first, right? And that's what many homeowners are going to be dealing with. So now as we look at that, we're moving into a skill-based market, 100% for sure. Get a tattoo on your arm. It's going to be a skill-based market and the things that you did may not work. And again, my message even to myself sounds like it could be a little doom and gloom at times. It's not. It creates opportunity when the market does this stuff. I'm excited about the flipping opportunities they're going to be and the wholesaling opportunities are going to come in the future. Are there going to be people that really are struggling moving their houses? And that's where we can come in and offer them a fast, quick close escrow and still make some spread on it and make some money. It's been really difficult to do the last couple of years. There was money to be made, but the risk was so much more intense that I stayed out of that space for 2 years. I haven't done a flip in 2 years. And now we're ramping back up for that, which, you know, includes vendors and reinitiating relationships with subcontractors and all these things, right? So skill-based market prospecting, broken record, prospecting-based marketing enhanced, right? That's just going to be so important for you guys to wrap your head around this. So skill-based market, be authentically you. Whatever your style is, be authentic to you and go all in on it, because there are going to be people that love you and will follow you, and you'll become their avatar for their real estate agent. That's who you want to be. You don't want to try and please everybody in this market, in my opinion. Pick your tribe, pick what you love to do. Maybe Kenny is all luxury and that's where you want to be, right? Stay in that space. Maybe you want to be the TikTok realtor. That's fine too. Stay in your space. Get really, really proficient at that and focus on attracting clients that are sticky to you, meaning that they will do business with you no matter what, right? Circle your wagons around those people. Don't try to please everybody. If you're in this middle ground trying to please everybody, then you're really not going to have a fanatical fan on one side of the coin. My opinion, you want a fanatical fan on this side and you want haters on that side. Okay, that sounds tough in this market, right? You want to be good to everybody, but it's not true. The more fanatical fans you have, the more that they're going to do business with you and only you, and you just keep circling your arms and wagons around them. And you will add contrast to your business. And that could be done a couple ways. I'm not saying be abrasive on purpose. I'm not saying be the guy that cusses like a sailor on purpose to identify yourself with bikers and cussers or whatever it may be, right? I'm just saying that you want to have your identity, your authenticity of you, whoever that is. You know, Jason's a rock star. He's a guitar player. He's been in bands. That may be his avatar of who he likes to hang out with. That may, you know, and rock and roll, right? But that may be contrasting to other people that don't attract to that. And that's okay, right? You want to look a little bit in your business, geographical and some of these things that come into play with these decisions of who your authentic self is. But at the end of the day, if you're authentically a Christian and you're high in your faith, lead with that, because other people will attract to it and you'll repel others, right? So happy to talk about examples and things, but I wanted to bring that up to you this morning. 2006 was a light switch. We all in the business at the time, we remember it. It was a light switch. It was like the news happened and then Lehman crashed and all these lending crashed and it never got better. It was a light switch that happened. I don't know the date, but it was in 2006 or 2006. Well, guess what? We have the date for 2022. It was March 16th, 2022. In 2 years, we'll remember that date, because if we look, that's when everything on the charts went boom. It just literally light switched. So we had another light switch event. You know, in 2006, it was due to predatory lending practices, but there's still a lot of scar tissue from 2006 for a lot of us. So you just have to be aware of who you're talking to. If they went through that, and acknowledging the PTSD, and focusing on the scar tissue of what the new market is, so you can let them know that this market's not the same. We're not going to have these 50% attract or depreciation on properties or going back in value 30, 40, 50% like we did in 06, 7, and 8. You know, I remember we were losing, we lost 26% value in one 12-month period. So that's 2% a month they were losing in value. And we're not going to have that this time as best guess, right? Nobody really has the true crystal ball, but there's nothing in line with us seeing that happen again. I think we're going to have very modest, if not zero, neutral appreciation, but inventory is going to skyrocket, already doing it. If you haven't, you know, watched that in your market, that's the one indicator I want you to watch daily is inventory. Because inventory is, we keep going up and write this down, 4 months, if you don't have this written down, 4 months puts us in a buyer's market, right? That's kind of the indicator that we're in a buyer's market territory. It's kind of like the bull and the bear in the stock market. 4 months of inventory, not 4%, 4 months of inventory is the equivalent of a buyer's market transition. And then when we get to about 5-6 months of inventory, it's straight up buyer's market. I think we could see 12-18 months of inventory again, like we saw in 06-07. Right. So in certain price categories and in certain geographical areas, luxury, all these things are going to be impacted. And you know, the proof's in the pudding as we go. But when you look at your authentic you, when you look at, you know, your avatar of who you want to become over the next couple of years and who you want to become it for. I love the story of Will Smith, brick by brick, just build it brick by brick. And in a year, you won't realize that you put 14,000 bricks down by those prospecting phone calls, and your business will be flourishing because you built a beautiful wall on a foundation, and it's brick by brick, you know. And if you haven't heard the story Brick by Brick by Will Smith, listen to it. It's really, really impactful. It sounds like the dad was almost slave driving the kids into building this manual labor brick wall at his business. They tore one down and built a new one, and you know, it's 5 foot underground. So for months, they didn't even get above ground. And then all of a sudden they got above ground, leveled with dirt, and they had a foundation to build off of. But they built physically this brick wall outside his dad's business. And it, every day after school for like a year, he said, or it might even been a couple years. And at the end, they had this beautiful, you know, beautiful wall, very, very well done, straight, level, true, and everything. And they're just kids, but they did it brick by brick by foundationally. You know, the dad was teaching them something outside of just getting a free wall built, right? And Will still thinks that's his greatest accomplishment and story of his life. And I love that about it. But look what you're building in your business, you know? I look at the business like three pieces: job, career, mission, right? Job is getting paid for your money, getting progress going. You're building a house, for instance, right? And then your career is what you turn into in this avatar. So in this explanation, you'd be building a church now. Your career is a church where your job was building a house, right? And then your mission is having a worship house of God, right? Just to the other extreme. You're like, now you've created something that's bigger than you, right? And that kind of follows suit with your job, career, and then your mission in your life. And it could relate into work. So I talked about home values likely increasing or being neutral. I do believe we're going to get to some 1-3% appreciation, maybe 5 in some areas that are still real hot, but we're not going to see 2% a month. And we're going to see retraction in some of the superheated markets. I mean, you know, the superheated markets, Sacramento, right? Texas, these are superheated. And there's still some industry that are going into these areas. Florida's a superheated market, Texas, Sacramento, Idaho, Boise, right? These are superheated markets that may see a lot of retraction just because they were superheated, meaning that they're going to adjust 10-15% because all of a sudden, everybody and their sister is not moving there like they were. So something to think about with your particular markets that's important. Rates are going to continue to go up and be unstable. They've talked about 9 rate increases, and who knows where the ceiling is, right? It's really going to be about getting in front of inflation. Personally, they have to get in front of inflation, and they're not going to stop until they do. When you're having professional conversations with the people, just say the rates are the rates are the rates. They're the rates for everybody. Yes, they suck to be at 6 when you could have got them at 2.5. It may suck at 8% when you could have got them today at 6. The reality is you need a house today. Don't worry about the rates. The rates are short-term. Yes, you're going to have a short-term cost associated, $300-$500 a month. It could be significant. But the refinances are going to be boom again down the road, right? As we get in front of this 18 months, 24 months, whatever it may be. So conversation-wise, hey, Kenny, yes, it sucks. Rates were 2.5. Now they're 6. Sucks. But the bottom line is you could still afford the house. Your payments are going to be about $400-$500 a month more. You're going to have to get lean for the next 2 years, but that's $500 a month. That's $6,000 a year. That's $12,000 over 2 years. This price, this house should appreciate over those 2 years, be a good investment. And in 2 years, we'll refinance and get that payment down $500, right? It's just that kind of a logical conversation, I think, is the best place for you to have with your clients now. Anybody disagree with that? That's okay. Anything I've talked about so far, is it making sense, or is it like, okay, Randy's full of crap?
I heard a quote just the other day. Another agent said, marry the house and date the rate. You know.
Oh, I like it. I like it a lot. Marry the house and date the rate.
The rate is temporary.
Yeah, no, I like that. And listen, if they have the ability to live in a trailer and wait 2 years, then that's an option, right? It's all about options. The option is you have to buy the rate money today, which is going to cost you, you know, a little bit extra, $200, $300, $500, sometimes a lot more. The more important question is how much they can qualify is probably changing, right? Instead of qualifying for six, now they only qualify for 480. That's a completely different looking real estate market at 480 versus six. That's the big questions. The reality is in higher price points, two to two and a half times average sales price is, you know, luxury. So in the luxury, there's a lot more cash involved. The rates are not as important, or they can move around portfolios and make it happen. But it just depends, right? Cash is still the same price. So if they had cash before and they have cash now, they have more power now because the cash buyer is still king, always will be. But we'll see less cash buyers with what's going on in the stock market, what's going on crypto, with what's going on in the housing industry, and their portfolios are just, you know, retracting. So it just depends. So inventory is the big thing to watch. Does anybody know their market statistics of what's gone on in the inventory in the last like 30 days or so? Yeah, Rich.
So I've been watching the price reductions have been between 10 and 15% in our market. I've been checking it about every 10 days for the past 8 weeks. I need to check it again. But I did talk with another agent that's been selling for 20 years that's plugged into some pretty good data also. And they were saying in some of the bigger markets like San Francisco Bay Area, they were seeing that 20% of all the listings were having price reductions. I know in our market, the average days on market has climbed considerably. I need to look to see what it was at, what it's at now. But it had climbed up to where it was like around 23 or 24 days.
Okay, awesome. So I've seen, like, I got a coaching client in Salt Lake. They had 5 days of inventory in March, and it's gone up. It went up in the first interest rate increase overnight. That market almost shut down, it felt like, and then it kind of picked back up again. So kind of an anomaly. But they're almost 2.5 months now. So they're at 2.5 months of 10 weeks of inventory from 5 days. And that's in 60 days. It went from 5 days to 2 months in a week's period. And you're like, how in the hell is that even possible? Because the market quit selling and people were rushing to get their homes on the market. So the inventory started increasing. And now the market's kind of got hot again, then it cooled off again. So, you know, they sell a lot of houses, 1,000 houses a year. It's easy to get your finger on the pulse of that one. Yes, Kenny.
Just to give you an idea, I'm in one of those heated markets, Sacramento area. I'm actually in golf. I'm not sure if you know where that's at, but just to give you an idea, in a heated market like Sac, in the last 7 days, 4,200 new listings. And
what's that in comparison, though?
I would say up 25%.
Oh, okay.
And then looking at price reductions in that same time period, last 7 days, almost 2,600.
Wow.
That's crazy.
Yeah, that's the real number to watch is price reductions, because the sellers are finally going to catch the news and see what's going on and listen to their agent finally and start being aggressive with that. But, you know, in my market, last 30 days we've had, and my market's much smaller, we've had 472 pendings in the last 30 days, down about 50%. And price changes are 527 in the last 30 days. So there's more price changes than pendings. And that price change is up, you know, obviously hundreds of a percent. So, you know, it is, you just got to watch the market to find out what's going on with saturation being days on market. Patrick?
Hey, Randy. I'm seeing an interesting thing. Is it the property? I'm in the same market. I'm actually up in Placer County, just outside of Sacramento. And what I'm finding is that the stuff that is selling is still hot. So if anybody's interested, everybody's interested. If nobody's interested, then it's crickets. And that's the price reductions. Is that it's like a tale of two markets.
It is. And again, remember, you still have a tremendous amount of buyers that were unavailable to find houses, right? So we have to go through some of that, and the interest rates are removing the amount of buyers that we have. Remember, I talked about 0.25% interest rate is equal to about losing about 10% of the buyers. So we've had a 1.5% interest rate increase now. So that's the equivalent of almost 40 to 50% of the buyer pool that's taken out of their price point or taken out of the affordability. Right? So that's a significant amount. At some point, we're going to reach a threshold where all of a sudden that curve is stopped, right? And then we're going to start going the other direction with the inventory and the amount of buyers. There's still going to be buyers. We're still going to sell 400 houses a week or whatever your market is normally available to do. So I hear, I believe it to be a little reckless, but I hear a lot of agents on TikTok and on social media now going, this is ridiculous. Don't listen to the people on the internet. The world's not coming to an end. We're still getting multiple offers. We're still doing all this. The market's great. I think that's reckless. Every indicator is proving different. But again, isolated geographically, you could have that being the case. It's strictly a supply and demand issue. And we do have about 2 million housing units short of what would be necessary for all the buyers to find homes, right? But that's not realistically going to happen. The builders are not going to build 2 million extra houses this year to take care of that supply. If they did, we would totally disrupt the market. But the reality is we've got multiple things that are affecting what's happening, right? And so we just got to be conscious of that and outproduce the problems. We've got to be skill-based in this market more than ever, okay? Anything else on those topics that we want to talk about before I go into, I think, the 7 things you could do to dominate this summer? And I think the 7 things I came up with will surprise some of you. Anything? I got raspberry seeds in my teeth because I'm having my morning shake. Sorry. It's good though. I probably got big old blueberries in my teeth. All right. So I was reading some past stuff on, how to stay healthy in this market and how to stay mentally fortified and all that stuff. And came up with some things that it's not mine. It's not my list of 7, but I liked it. And immediately it was kind of surprising to me, which I think you'll see the same thing, but 7 things to dominate your business this selling season, this spring, summer season. Number 1, slow down. Take time for yourself. Doesn't that sound contrasting to everything I'm saying? It could, or it could not, right? If you're really, really laser focused on slowing down to take time, we've been burning ass for 2 years in this market, right? we have been burning the candle potentially at both sides for the last 2 years. It's not time to take a month off. That's not what I'm saying. I'm saying, number 1, take care of yourself, recharge your batteries, slow down, take time to really evaluate what you want to do and what you want to be and who you want to be in this new market that we're in now for the next 18 to 24. Number 2, family time, being very purposeful about planned family time, right? Again, to me, when I wrote this list, it sounded contrasting to what I'm talking about, but it's not. It's actually totally in alignment with it, because we're going to have to find another gear. We're going to have to find another gear where it's been almost pretty easy to do real estate the last couple of years. I mean, how hard was it to sell a house? Come on. Don't tell me some of you haven't done a listing with your iPhone because you know it's going to sell before you even get the photography back in a week. So you take a couple pictures with your iPhone and schedule a photographer for 7 days from now, right? That's what's been going on in this market. So number 3, learning time. Really being purposeful about bettering yourself knowledge-wise in this market, so you can really spend the time to read books and subscribe to newsletters and stay abreast of it, whether it's Inman or whether it's, current matters or whatever it may be. or this, you know, the coaching channels and things that you could plug into. Really, really commit to those things. And if you're here, I'm proud of you. You're already committed to that piece of it. Number four, having fun with clients. Over the last couple of years, we've been breakneck speed, probably haven't done a lot of client parties, probably haven't done the things that could be valuable for us to wrap our wagons around our sphere of influence, past clients and database, right? If you're a Buffini guy, pop buys, that's valuable. And this goes across industry. It's not just real estate, but if you think about this, right? Contractors have been burning it hard for the couple of years as well. So it's easy to chase that win when it's winning. It's going to be even more important to really identify those things now in this changing market and be purposeful about that. Number five, review business plan. This is a good time. We changed, right? The market changed. And if you had a business plan, you can almost rip it up and throw it away in some regards. We may have to change our mathematical equations for prospecting to close ratios, right? Those things are changing and have changed. We definitely want to get thin on expenses. I'm not telling you it's a nuclear winter coming, but it sure would be nice for you to plan for one. Right? Are you in a position to go 6 months without an escrow closing? And if you're not, be really clear on your expenses now. And listen, I'm literally making more money monthly than I've ever made in my life, times maybe two. And we're doing the same things. We're having the same conversations. We're saying, what are our A and B categories? A are things we want to cut now that we just know are fluffy. When COVID happened, we went through and did an A and B list. Like A is what we know is fluffy, we need to cut now. And B is kind of, if it gets lean, this is what we need to do. And what happened in COVID? We got lean for about 3 weeks and all of a sudden it went, and it's been that way ever since. So B is maybe never get to it, but B, identify it now. So A list, when I went through at the beginning of COVID, we had $4,000 of monthly expenses that were $19.95 for Buffer, $19.95 for Apple iTunes, $9.99 for this, $799 for that, right? We had my coaching. I was paying $2,000 a month coaching. I don't get rid of coaching, but it was on the list for the B, right? So really being purposeful about looking at the expenses you have in your business. And I can't emphasize this enough. This is really the one thing. And it doesn't matter what profession you're in, but right now we're talking about real estate lending specifically. Review that business plan, get real on it, and have a contingency plan of the A is all the stuff you can cut out now. Like I'm in five MLSs because my teams, I try to give them value in all my areas that I have a team in physically. I don't need $1,000 or $1,500 a month with the MLS dues. There's just no need for it, right? They have access. I have opportunities, but in a booming market, it didn't matter. Okay, makes sense. My Wise Hire was $199 a month. It's been on for a year. I didn't even know it. It's just $199 a month. I don't need anybody. I haven't ran an ad in 8 months since I hired my assistant. But yet an audit allowed me to identify that and kill it until I need it. Makes sense? All right. Number six, lean into direct mail. This is maybe a controversial one where some people feel like it's totally not good. Matter of fact, Tom Ferry right now was interviewing a couple of top agents and they go, worst thing you can do right now. And two or three of them said direct mail. It depends. It depends on you. I think direct mail is a great opportunity and it's an opportunity for you to start differentiate yourself amongst your competitors in this market. And it's all going to be about top of mind. So if you're not leading with sweat equity, lead with check equity, direct mail, and stay in touch with your people, right? You could do newsletters, direct mail. You could do postcards. You could do geographic farming. But I think direct mail is going to be an important element of that. And then being purposeful about how you're working that direct mail and what you're doing in your business to enhance that. So if you have direct mail, then door knocking or a coat drive or a dumpster day in a subdivision, all those things could be valuable for you to supplement and complement that. And then number seven is step up prospecting. Whatever you've been doing in a prospecting based formula, you've got to double down on that and step it up. And you notice at the beginning, I'm like, take more time for yourself, have more fun, do stuff, prospecting more, right? We've got to add those things into our business. And if you were prospecting 1 hour a day in 2021 and 2022, and you did 20 deals next year, you might need to prospect 2 or 2.5 hours a day to maintain that level of production. So depending on your goals aligned with what you're wanting to accomplish, these things are going to be, you know, managed for your own business of what you want to accomplish. And then you've got to separate it. Is it building your team? That requires some specific prospecting. Is it building your seller base? That requires specific prospecting. Maybe a CMA a day. Maybe you're doing 1 or 2 CMAs a day. Maybe you're doing farming postcards. Maybe you're door knocking specific areas. I've got new coaching clients that are door knocking, right? Because that's a tried and proven way to meet people on a basis that's somewhat predictable. If you knock on 100 doors a day and you talk to 20 people a day, 20%, I can mathematically lay out your opportunities based on some numbers and formulas. Okay. So that's what I had on my list to go over with you guys today. I want to open it up for Q&A, questions, anything. And then if you have something you want the recording to go off on, just ask me because we'll record this. It will go to the page for coaching nuggets and future, you know, people to be able to watch the past coaching calls. But if there's something sensitive or something that you just don't want to be recorded, let me know and we'll pause it. But for now on the recording, any questions on that content, any feedback, any ahas, any Randy's full of it, anything?
Sounds like automations are even more important now in a way, like
to automation
systems. Yeah, implementing systems to be able to free up another hour or two for that prospecting.
Yeah, and more importantly, yes. More importantly to me is not dropping the ball, right? Not fumbling the opportunity, not fumbling the ball. And if you do fumble it, kick it forward so you can pick it up 10, 15 yards down the road and still be advancing, right? So with that being said, lead generation, speed to lead, critical, because the competition is going to be much stricter, much stiffer, right? So to me, a system is like new buyer lead comes in. What's the system that allows that buyer to be maximized at the onset of that lead coming on? Contact within 5 minutes, a drip campaign and a marketing snapshot set up on the first day, right? An introduction text that allows you to build some rapport and relationship with them. That's to me what a system looks like. Okay, not automating it so you never have to talk to them until they decide that they want to be a buyer, right? It's a contact sport. We've got to be at the forefront of that. But good takeaway. What else?
I mean, it feels like there's some good opportunity out here. I mean, with a little bit of shakeup in the variables and all the stuff in the media, a lot of the fence sitters and people that are out there that haven't been sure about listing or doing, now all of a sudden they're all shaken up. So probably is a good time to really be putting yourself from a prospecting standpoint in front of more people. There's probably a lot more conversations that can be had easier now because the ones that were sitting on the fence, they're thinking we should have done something already. We better do something now. So maybe there's some opportunity from that standpoint.
I think there's truth in that, Rich. I really do. And, you know, I think it's good because it was an unbalanced market. We didn't have any balance in our market. It was just all sellers, buyers were waiving everything. And you know, it's very frustrating for a buyer. So I think the buyer sentiment's much more optimistic. The sellers have been spoiled in the last couple of years, you know, me included. I'm looking at my house that I love going, man, that's a lot of money. I should sell it, but then what, right? We all have the same dialogue. So the reality is, I think, again, back to the professionals, back to the agents that are, you know, skill-based in this market, focusing on their language, focusing on their scripts, practicing their scripts again. You know, you didn't need scripts to sell houses in the last 2 years. They helped, but they weren't necessary, right? Hey, I saw a house on the corner. I want to offer $100,000 over asking price. We can close in 2 weeks. We'll waive everything. No inspections, no contingencies, appraisal gap. You know, you can't even come look at it. It's just, that's what's been going on in our market. So getting back to a normal based market allows you to negotiate, allows you to be an agent that's adding value to the transaction again. And you got to work on the seller side too. You know, you got to price it correctly. You got to market it correctly. Now you got to, you know, staging and photos and all these things are going to be important again. Where the last, again, couple of years, you couldn't even get that stuff in place fast enough. So we were pre-listing houses for up to 3 weeks to get to a status, you know, to get them live on the market. And say that package costs $1,500 or $2,000. If you could put it on with your cell phone tomorrow versus two or three weeks from now and sell it just as fast, why bother? Right. So those days might be gone. And what you really want to be cautious of is not making the mistake, of thinking the market's still hot, putting it on there with crappy camera phone photos and not doing the necessary marketing and announcements and launches and maybe staging and all these other things, and then get caught with your pants down and the market's turning and you're chasing it down. Because I've had with my coaching clients lots of conversations over the last 4 weeks. What should we do? We listed it here. Should we price it to this, or should we do staging now, or should we take it off and do that exterior paint and put new countertops in now that hasn't sold? Well, you've created a dog in the market now. The dog is not going to get much prettier with a different dog collar. Oh, sorry, Jason, I didn't see your hand. You must have been on the other page. Yes, sir.
I just raised it. Where does a program like HomeBids fall into like a market like this where, you know, 14, 21 day listings? You know, where does something like that fall in line in a market like this?
Well, I think there's value in it because a seller is a lot less likely to get in a place feeling like they got to sign a 6 month listing agreement with an agent. So I think it's an advantage where you say, hey, you know, the market is still hot enough to support this. But as it continues, I wouldn't take 11-day listing appointment or listing agreements and do any work, because the average time in the market is where we've got to focus on that, right? But I think that those particular platforms are much better in a market that we saw, right? A hot seller market, those platforms work very well. But there's value for them in the FSBO market. Remember, the FSBOs are struggling just as likely. So FSBO is a great opportunity to have an agent conversation with them and bridge the gap of the commission gap conversation.
And then also like possibly like maybe consider a little bit longer listing periods than 14 days.
Yeah. I mean, you know, even with HomeBids, I wouldn't do them for under 30 days. I mean, that's still a short period of time.
Yeah. Okay.
But there's a company in Arizona, they're called 724 Real Estate, and they guarantee to sell your house in 7 days. And they basically put a package together that's like an online bidding package, right? Platform. And very similar issues and pieces in it. But again, in a changing market, that's going to be challenged. It's going to be tougher to have 7 day. Now they pre-market it for 21 days. They have it on their sites. There's a whole bunch of things in the backside of that where they're trying to double end them and everything else. And they just partnered with Keller Williams. Matter of fact, I read in the article. But the reality is that was a beautiful model 2 months ago, and it may be a challenged model now.
Yeah, I would think quite the opposite, because now it's even more relevant to get the most eyes on the property in the shortest amount of time.
Yeah.
Because of, you know, you're starting from the other side, you know, everybody's, most sellers are chasing the market down.
Yeah.
So I guess time will tell.
Well, that's the whole thing. There's no crystal ball and time will tell. But if you miss it, you know, when you miss it, you might have missed it significantly. So you've got to get in front of the market. one of the things, you know, I took 90 listings one year in the height of my running a team. And the one thing that we did was aggressive price reduction. We wouldn't let agents or sellers do this little $3,000-$5,000 price reduction. You had to make an adjustment, right? If it's a price improvement, it's going to be an improvement, not just a ploy to get your thing at the top of the MLS on Friday. I've done both in my career, by the way. You know, we used to reduce it $1,000 on Friday, so it hit the hot sheet for the weekend. All my listings, $1,000, and it's just a game. But the reality is, it depends on the market. I don't think this market's going to be that. I think this market is going to be, you have to be the bride, not the bridesmaid. If you have 27 priced houses in your category, you've got to be aggressively in the front end of that 27 houses, because there might only be three buyers for 27 houses. And then you got another 12 coming on next week, and another 12, and another 12. And so that's why I think there's going to be dogs that we could look at that are not really dogs. We're just going, what's wrong with that, man? That thing should have sold like crazy, but it's sitting there, and it's sitting there, but that becomes an opportunity, right? These buyers are going to start looking for houses that are on the market 21 days and going, dog, I could be aggressive. I just believe that's where we're going and where we're at. Okay. Anything else on the recording that I can help you with and talk about today? Okay. I'm going to stop the recording so we put that onto the site. Thanks. Have a good day for that.